We're working on it.
Maybe a little $5 membership fee or something like that. Okay, well, it's time to bring out our fourth guest to join the panel now. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to welcome 2004 Olympic champion in the K1 500 meter and 2007 world champion, Adam van Koeverden, everybody. Come on, Adam.
You guys got a great band.
Not bad, eh? It's not bad. They're very cheap. They're very cheap, as you can imagine. I haven't had a chance to get the sponsorship up to the level where we can get a live band yet, but next year. So I wanted to start with the question I asked Alex. Obviously, you know, paddling became your thing, but do you think because of your drive that you could have, if you'd chosen another sport, you think you could have reached the level in another sport?
Alex and I were talking about something similar to that on the way here, actually, and my answer is similar to his, which is probably not. And actually, I use swimming as the example. So before you ask that question, I wouldn't have been a good swimmer for a variety of reasons. I mean,
what happens
I'm
if
lucky
your boat
that
tips?
I can swim with one hand in my boat, but still not as fast as I can paddle faster than any swimmer can. But that's beside the point. I don't think there is another sport out there that would have allowed me to find the success that I did in kayaking. I found my sport at a really, really perfect time in my life. I started kayaking at a later age than most do, when I was 13. And the reason that I went down to the canoe club wasn't because I had Olympic dreams or because I wanted to be an athlete or even because I wanted to be in shape or anything like that. It was because my mom needed a place to store me after school, basically. And the canoe club was a cheap alternative to any other activity, basically. The canoe club offered great male role models, which is something my mom was concerned with as she raised me and my brother, primarily by herself. My father lived in the same city, but we saw him like every other weekend kind of thing. So she found the canoe club was just a really good place for me to be after school and basically stay out of trouble. The national team stuff and the progression through that system was sort of incidental. I mean, it became my goal at a certain point in my life, but honestly, that's not why I started in sport. I do a lot of school talks, and usually I start the school talks by asking, like, who's on the track and field team, who's on the soccer team, who's on the volleyball, basketball teams, whatever, and I say, you guys are lucky. I tried out for all those teams, and I didn't make any of them in elementary school. You guys are all really great athletes. I wasn't a good athlete growing up. I wasn't, you know, I didn't stand out in a crowd size-wise or skill-wise in any sport, and I was very fortunate to find one that I could excel at. It took a lot of work. But that's just kayaking. You spend 2-3 months falling out of your boat, and that's a wider boat than I currently use. And you just sort of progress through the boats and sort of eventually find yourself in the fastest one, which is also the tippiest one and the most difficult to use. I tell these kids that I wanted to be the best at something at St. John's Elementary when I was 12 or 13 years old. So I went the cheap route, and I found something that nobody else does at the school, so automatically when I went down to the canoe club, I was the best kayaker at St. John's Elementary.
What's the level of organization, I don't know, of canoe clubs across the country as it relates back to the national body?
It's very similar to swimming. It's just on a smaller scale. Obviously, we're limited. It's an outdoor sport, and it's a summer sport, so Canada's not the best place to paddle kayaks, obviously. It's very cold. It's very cold now. I actually skipped practice today to come here, so I didn't have to. Today in Toronto was actually beautiful, though. It was 15 degrees. I would have enjoyed it. But yesterday was pretty miserable, and like every day from now until
So why doesn't
January
the
NSO for
Canoe Kayak relocate to like Costa Rica or something like
that? Well, that's another thing that we talked about in the car. Well, no, honestly, that's a good point, and I'll touch on it for a second. I was suggesting, you know, if we are going to spend money on a Canadian, like, amalgamated sports center for summer sport, then why would we put it in Canada? It just seems natural to go somewhere cheap, like the Turks and Caicos, and say, hey, you guys have an old resort you can sell us, and buy an old resort with a 50-meter pool or put in a 50-meter outdoor pool. Make sure it's close to a lake or a river. Then you've got swimming, rowing, and canoe kayak covered.
Alex, can I just say that I'm willing to go and run it?
I was going to say, Pierre, we have to have our meetings down there.
So there's clearly lots of perks WestJet flies to the Turks and Caicos now, just so you know.
I can see you've put a lot of thought into this.
Yeah.
That's right.
But back to the organization question. I think Pierre and I decided that there's about a fifth of the number of clubs and paddlers in Canada. It might be a tenth, might be so somewhere between 10 and 20% of the involvement. And not every aspect, not every discipline in canoe kayak is an Olympic event. So we have women's canoe, which we don't do at the Olympics. We do war canoe in Canada, which is where we get the majority of the kids involved. And war canoe is just like dragon boat. It's a big 15-person canoe, and it's a huge club thing, and I still race for my club, and all the national team, you have 9 national team guys at my club, and we all still race dragon boat. We hate dragon boat. War canoe at the end of the year, it's a big, senior men's war canoe is a huge thing at the nationals. We usually have, nationals is the same in canoe kayak as it is in swimming, you have to qualify, but we qualify in regions, so everything out west, surprisingly very little involvement out west. Western Ontario and Eastern Ontario are 2 different divisions. Quebec's a different division than the Atlantic division. And they send a variety, I think it's like 5, average of 5 per event, you know, from each whatever. So you end up getting about 27 entries from Canada at nationals. We just have 3 heats of 9. And I think there's usually something like 2,000 competitors. So it's smaller than your sport, but.
2,000 competitors would be a hell of a nationals, though. That'd be pretty good.
Yeah, we have war canoe, though. I mean, like literally 1,000 of them are probably only paddling war canoe. And I don't know if Masters is in that number. Maybe you can ask Anne Merklinger, she knows.
So
we all know her.
Not anymore,
but she still knows, Pierre.
That's right. That's right. She didn't just forget.
Ask Lorraine Lafreniere, our new boss. We have a new boss.
So earlier we were talking about that statement that compromise is the cancer of achievement. Like, what's your feeling on just compromise and how it relates to sport and how it may be related to your success?
I think that's I'm going to play devil's advocate a little bit. I think that's kind of a blanket statement, and it really depends on what aspect of compromise you're talking about. There's a lot of relationships in sport, and I think any relationship takes compromise. You know, and if you're talking about skipping practice in order to go to school, then obviously that's not something that you want to encourage. But at the same time, if you're going to be achieving more than one thing in your life, which Alex touched on, is a very important thing. I think going to school and being an athlete go hand in hand, as long as you have the support of the academia that you're involved with, whether it's high school or university. As long as they're aware of the fact that you're trying to accomplish more than one goal concurrently, then generally I've found that they've always been fairly supportive. As long as you're, you know, and I guess this is a conversation that I should have with kids involved in sport who are trying to convince their teachers to let them go to training camps in the middle of the school year. Basically just approaching it saying, I don't want time off, I need time away, and I'm going to be working for you. I just have to be doing it from a remote location because of my other goals. And in university, it was a little bit easier because the first day in each class, I just go to my professor and say, hey, this is my situation. I'm going to be gone a lot. If I send you like 12 emails this semester, will you respond and will I have your support? And can I write my exams at another university in Australia or in Florida or whatever? And if they said no, then I'd say, well, thanks. I'm not going to be taking your class. I have to go to the registrar's office now and find a professor who's more supportive. Thankfully, I was in kinesiology, so most of the professors were akin to sport in general, and they're actually pretty excited to have me in their class. So this is long before any Olympic success or
right. You
know, anything like that. I'd say, hey, I'm on the national kayak team. It's like 2001, 2002. A couple of years, I want to go to the Olympics. What do you think? Can you help me out? And most of them were like, absolutely, let's do it. What can we do?
So how much of a role does coaching and the support of coaching play in paddling sport and for you?
Well, coaching is obviously really important in every sport, but I've noticed it's quite different in our sport than it is in a lot of others. It's very difficult to be a hands-on coach in canoe kayak because you can't just watch your athlete do what they're doing the whole time unless you have a very big tower. Or if you're in a motorboat, and if you're training on a small body of water like we do at the Burl Oak Canoe Club, which is, as Scott Oldershaw, my coach, says, a pretty damn productive 2-kilometer stretch of muddy, shitty water.